my pleasure to welcome you all here this evening for our candidates for through the 39th Congressional District. We have a number of exciting races in this district, and we always feel that informed citizens are the best to be out there to elect the best representatives. So thank you for being here to become informed about what's going on. My co-host this evening is the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, and it's my pleasure to introduce Vartan Dajarian, the manager of the Western Regional Office.
Thank you, Teresa, and thanks to the entire team here at the North Orange County Chamber of Commerce for putting this event together. And really, for me, Washington was actually a pretty good year for the small business community. We were able to achieve tax reform, regulatory reform, and we were able to keep a pro-business majority on the Supreme Court. And that's why the question now is whether momentum is going to continue. And that's why this upcoming election is going to be so critical. And this district, the 39th Congressional District, is really going to be ground zero to determine which direction this country will go in the next Congress. So we're really, really excited to be here tonight and very excited to hear from all the candidates. And with that, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our moderator tonight, Mr. Rick Reed. It's a real treat for us to have Rick with us because he's a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist. He is the editor at large for the Orange County Business Journal, and he is the host and producer of Inside OC with Rick Reed, which airs on PBS SoCal and KDOC. So please help me welcome Mr. Rick Reed.
Thank you, and good evening, and thanks to all of you for coming. Thanks to the chamber for asking me to do this, and thanks to you folks for all the investment that you have to make to do what you're doing. And as Vartan said, this is ground zero. This is according to Politico, one of the ten one of the top ten races to watch in the country this year, as the control of Congress really hangs in the balance. And I think you will find out tonight the folks here are a diverse group. You know, oftentimes you'll have a district where everybody's kind of trying to look the same, and then you'll have somewhere somebody's here and somebody's there, and it's very clear it's a winner take all. And here we've got folks all very distinctive, different backgrounds, different viewpoints, and it really is, I think, a microcosm of what's going on in this nation. So anyway, I'm looking forward to the evening, and you're here because you are too. Some ground rules. First of all, the questions tonight will tend to be business oriented, but I suspect we'll get into everything that you're interested in. There will be, if any of you want to ask a question, we might take a couple of questions from the audience. So if you're interested, raise your hand. There's folks going around. They'll bring index cards and hopefully a pen or something that you can write on, and so you can submit a question, and then there might be a couple passed to me tonight. We'll go in order here. It was totally arbitrary decision to go in alphabetical order as far as the way you line up the folks here. So surprising, Bob. With Huff, I would think you don't normally expect to be first in alphabetical order, but in this group you are. And so we'll start with you, and then the second time we'll go to you, Mr. Jamal. And so we'll start each time with a different person, so hopefully it will all work out and be fair and all that. It'll be 90 seconds for the introductory statement, and probably for most of the answers, I'll allow 90 seconds. If anybody is referenced, impugned, criticized in any way during another candidate's statement, that person will have 30 seconds for a rebuttal. It'll be 60 seconds closing, and I might even throw in some kind of quick questions that would only be 30 seconds. And Janine and Anthony from the chamber have the toughest job tonight because they're going to be keeping time. And I will let you finish a sentence, or a long word, but I'm going to try to keep it moving. So when you hit the time, I'll just say time's up. Please don't make me be rude and shut me down totally. So okay, great. So let's get going. Let's start with the opening statements. And Mr. Huff, why don't you go first? And in any state. statements. You have 90 seconds. You know, give us obviously your name, the title you would like most associated with you, and then just tell us, you know, who you are and why you're running. So, Mr. Huff.
Well, I'm Bob Huff. In the title, I'd like you to know me as winner, but, you know, that takes a few points. You can laugh a little bit more. Loosen up. We're going to have fun tonight. Many of you know my background, and I am running for Congress, in case you missed that part. Many of you know my background, former Senate Republican leader, assembly member, mayor, council member, small business owner. And so this is a great opportunity to run. We have a lot of challenges in our nation. But, you know, as you look around, and we have a very divided country right now. But I can tell you from my years of experience that progressives or liberals don't understand that you can't create prosperity by taxing, regulating, pursuing those the right paychecks, that you can't have an underfunded military and porous borders, it puts the country at risk, and that you can't have other countries stepping on us and creating prosperity. So my priorities in Congress are simple. Keep our military stronger, secure our borders, cut the fat out of our budget, protect our freedoms, and make our military stronger. So I'm proud that I was 100% rated by the National Federation of Independent Business of the state, as well as the California Chamber of Commerce. While I was Senate Republican leader, I was able to keep a lid on new taxes and help kill billions in additional taxes. I expect to keep that record going as I get back to Congress. So I keep getting these signs up here a little distracting, but let me just tell you, I've continued to be a strong champion for business. Thank you for being here tonight.
Yes, and maybe I should say that each of the candidates, if you do want to watch that, you'll be queued at 30 seconds, 15 seconds, and then time's up. And thank you for mentioning it. We're talking about Congress here. That was good. And, of course, also the seat that was held for many years by Congressman Ed Rice. We should mention his name, too. So this will be a big change in many ways in this district. Mr. Jamal.
Thank you, Rick. Thank you, the Chamber. Thank you, everyone, for being here today. We're one of the most watched races in the country, and we have an obligation here to have a conversation on how we're going to move our community forward. What is the next generation going to look like for that American dream? And I'm running because I grew up here, and I know we've got a lot of challenges ahead, but I'm optimistic about our future together. See, there are two questions driving American politics today. What does it mean to be an American, and is the American dream still alive? That first question, what does it mean to be an American? We're seeing that division day to day and people being cut out of that definition. That's not our community. You see, I'm the son of immigrants. My mom's from South America, my father's from the Middle East. This has been a welcoming country. It's been a country where you can come from nothing and work your way up and work your way to get ahead. I started, used to bus tables at Black Angus and La Habra, used to work at Bray Mall, down the road worked for the President of the United States, President Obama at the Commerce Department, and then I was a chief of staff in Congress. I came home for that second question, is the American dream still alive? Working in clean energy, creating jobs in the future, and that's what this is about. That's what this forum is about. It's about how are we going to create those jobs in the future? Can we help our small businesses start that next great American company? Can we bring jobs here and replace those that are losing? We lost Kimberly Clark. How do we bring more jobs here? And how do we do it in a way that brings our community together? And it's about strategic investments. It's about driving a welcoming community so immigrants feel like they can invest here and start their families and business here. And it's about all of us being leaders. So Sam Jamal, running here in the 39, look forward to this conversation and look forward to the questions, Rick.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rick. Thank you to North Orange County Chamber for hosting this forum today. It's an opportunity for you to get to know the candidates and for us to have a dialogue to show you where we stand on different issues. I'm sure you're going to get to hear many of us talk about American Dream, and Sam, you touched on that. I am truly living the American Dream. I'm an immigrant from South Korea. My parents brought me over here over 4 decades ago. I grew up on the island of Guam. I went to Hawaii and then came to California. After I graduated from college, I went to work in a private sector as a controller, and I also owned my small business. And then I had the opportunity to go and work for a then state senator who, a couple years later, would won a seat in the congressional district. That 39th congressional district, which we are all trying to run for. It's been an honor to represent the 39th Congressional District as a congressional staff working side by side with Congressman Ed Royce, working on the issues that matter to you, the community, helping constituents with the daily constituent cases that you come and expect us to help with. I've been able to do that. From one corner to other in the 39th Congressional District, I had the privilege of representing you. And then in 2014, I want to see to break the two-thirds supermajority in the state assembly. I've been very, very proud to be the one person to be sure that we bring this pro-business, pro-job, job-oriented, minded person, and that's me. I am living the American dream, and I hope that we'll have a productive conversation so you will get to know us too. Thank you so much.
Mr. Nelson.
Good evening and welcome to Fullerton. As many of you know, this is my hometown. I live in a home one of my best friends grew up in, and the evidence of leadership and my ability to work with people of all points of view is all around us, because with Sharon Quirk's help, she and I focused on helping our city and building this jewel of a facility you're sitting in that benefits everyone, young and old. That's how I've worked with people the entire time I've been in public life. I gave up my private business to become your county supervisor 8 years ago. I have produced results for our residents from the moment I got there. The OC Bridges project, we spent $700 million putting the train over the roadways. We have done an incredible job modernizing our freeway system. And with homeless, we do a better job than our neighbors all around us. It is a tragedy, but it's something we've been dealing with and we're getting a handle on, and the veterans of our country deserve better, and they will get better. We have got to move on. We've got to focus ourselves on figuring out how to get American values and understanding that it is not inappropriate to focus on Americans first. It is our responsibility. The number one thing we can do to help middle-class families and young millennials going forward is college tuition and books should be 100% tax deductible for anyone that pays them. Thank you.
Mr. Thorburn.
Thank you. And thank you all for coming. If you can't hear me, is this okay?
Mic's not working.
How's this? Okay. I'm Andy Thorburn, and now I have a mic that works. It's always a good start. Well, I'm running for Congress because I want to tell you that I don't think this country is going in the right direction. When I think of the values of high ethics, a value of an orderly administration, when I think of the kind of thoughtfulness that I want in administration, when I think of the way I think the United States should deal with foreign countries, when I think of the way the United States should be building towards an inclusive society, I don't think we're going in the right direction. I've been a classroom teacher, I've been a union organizer, and I've been an international businessman. I believe that progressives understand business as well as anybody. I've been in business for myself since I was 28 years old. I was a member of the Chamber of Commerce, the United States Chamber of Commerce. My company's been a member of that Chamber of Commerce in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, in Amsterdam, in the Netherlands, and even in Belgrade. I was the guest speaker at the United States Chamber of Commerce in Belgrade, Serbia, on the day that Serbia entered the European Union. So I know from a worker's point of view and from a businessman's point of view what it takes to make small business successful. I started my first business at 28. I was very successful. I had an unsuccessful business. I went through bankruptcy. So I've had SBA loans. I've had bankruptcy experience. Hope not to do it again. I'm not trying to repeat that. But I've had that experience. I know what it takes to help companies recover from bad times. Our bankruptcy code needs to be revised again to make it easier for companies to get ahead. So I have the business experience to bring to the table. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello everyone. I'm Dr. Mike Montran, and I'm a pediatrician who's lived and practiced here in Orange County for 25 years. As a small business owner, I want to thank the Chamber for all the work that you've done on behalf of small business owners everywhere. Now, I'm running for Congress because of two little girls. The first one is my daughter, Gracie. I'm worried that the vision of America that she sees is not the same that I saw when I first came to the US as a refugee. When that soldier carried me off the plane, he represented to me this country, the best this country, a place that's warm, receiving and kind and really caring for those in need. That's not the America I see today. The other 5-year-old is a patient with a brain tumor who I saw the day after the election. Her family had just gotten help through the Affordable Care Act, and her mom was petrified at the loss of care at this crucial time for my patient. That's when I decided to fight. Now, I've been a fighter all my life. I fought to build a medical practice with my partners that won the best medical group in Orange County for 2017, and I fought to be a responsible business owner by making sure that all of my employees have health insurance and retirement benefits, and we won the best workplace in Orange County for 2015. So I have the compassion, the passion, the commitment, as well as the skills and the expertise to make sure that all of our families have quality health care and the opportunities we need to thrive in this great country. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, now to the questions, and let's start with tax reform and tax cuts. As you know, a few months back, the Congress passed tax reform both for businesses and individuals. Some debate over how it impacts individuals. I think whether you're for it or against it, it was a cut in corporate taxes. So starting with you, Mr. Jamal, if you were, and you have 90 seconds each of you to answer this, if you were in Congress, would you have voted for this tax package? And if not, why not? And to those who would have voted for it, you know, is there anything you would have changed about it?
Thanks for the question. And if I were in Congress, I would have opposed this tax reform bill for a few reasons. Number one, it adds $1.5 trillion to our federal deficit. That's not good governance. Number two, it was focused on just the largest corporations and repatriation from companies doing business overseas, and not enough on small business owners. And number three, it took away the individual mandate, which is going to completely destabilize our healthcare system. It was reckless, and it was just an attempt to try and get a win in Congress after a rough year for the Republican Party. If I were in Congress, I wouldn't have just opposed it. I would have also offered my own alternative bill. I do think we need to lower that rate, but it should be focused on small business owners, especially in those first 3 to 5 years. You see, my sister's a small business owner, and I saw her struggle as she was trying to get her company off the ground. Those first 3 to 5 years, it's life and death for a small business. You should have that lower rate, so you can be investing in your employees and your idea. Second, the middle class needs that tax cut. We should have focused more of the tax cut on child care credits, college education, as well as just those health care costs, whether it's your out-of-pocket costs if you're a senior or if you're that small business owner trying to get by. The problem with this tax reform bill, it was written by lobbyists, meant to favor lobbyists, and it wasn't meant for the families in this district. And I know this because I worked in Congress as a chief of staff, and I worked in the Senate as a counsel. The system isn't working for us. We need representation that fits us and that knows us and is going to fight for us. And when it comes to tax reform, that did not happen, and that's why I would go up there and fix it next year.
Sorry.
The reason you can pass the tax reform bill, anything that comes out of Washington, D.C. probably is not the most perfect one, but I think this is a step in the right direction. It does give increased child tax credit. It doubles the standard deductions. We already see some businesses coming back to the United States from overseas. That's what this tax reform bill has done. And it's not just for cutting the corporate taxes low. This has tax cuts for all people across the board. Now, there is one thing that I would do differently, of course. There is a cap on SALT, which is this state and local taxes. I would like to see that coming back, and I would like to make that continue. And then there is a middle tax cuts that I would like to see it permanent. I have talked to some businesses who said they are already seeing the net positives. This is going to help our economy. But most importantly, bringing back the jobs back here is going to allow companies to hire more people from locally. That is going to provide stability in our families who depend on those jobs. I think it's not perfect. There is a room for growth, but like you said, those are the areas that I would like to see. Middle-class tax cuts make permanent, bring full SALT deduction back. When I get to Congress, I'll work to make sure those things happen. Thank you.
Thank you. It's infuriating to watch Washington because they take good things and screw them up. But in fairness, we needed corporate tax reform. There are hundreds of billions of dollars that were stuck overseas. And if I have the number correct, it's been a while since I looked at it, but just Apple alone repatriating their funds, they were looking at paying $28 billion in taxes year one. That's money that should be in the United States, however it should. Whether it's used by a corporation to buy and invest, whether it's used for their employees, and you're seeing corporation after corporation giving out bonuses, giving out pay raises in places like the Midwest for $15 an hour, it is a decent wage for the lower end. And it's something that people are pushing for across the country. These companies did it voluntarily because they were motivated and given the opportunity to. It's unfortunate that California puts us at such a disadvantage by taxing us on incomes and property so high. It made a disproportionate effect in California. That's unfortunate. Had I been in Congress, I think the one thing that I would hope to have moved the needle on is to have indexed the write-off so that at least people live in the most expensive areas of the country, like you do in the military. If you get housing allowance, your allowance is different if you live in the Midwest versus if you live deployed in Tokyo. So there's a right way to do this. It could have been done better, but in the end, I would have voted.
I think this works now, okay? We now have two working microphones. Without any help from the government. I would have voted no for this tax bill. Of course, like any bill as large as this is, there are some good things you can extract from it. But let me tell you the factual reasons why it was a bad bill looked at objectively. Number one, of every $3 in tax cuts in this bill, $1 went to working families, and $2 went to the highest 10% of the country and multinational companies. $2 of every three went to multinational companies, not small businesses, and the highest earning 10% of people in the country. Number two, it added to the deficit. You don't add to the deficit by cutting taxes when the economy is growing and unemployment is low. You add to the deficit when unemployment is high and the economy is not growing, as we did under President Bush, and then under President Obama during the recession. You do not add to the deficit at this time just for the purpose of a tax cut. Third of all, it lowered the maximum tax rate on highest earners, and we already have the lowest maximum tax rate of any country in the Western world. The highest earnings, which include me, should be paying more taxes, not less. And last of all, it did something I think is outrageous. It increased the tax exemption for estates to $22 million. So people can now leave $22 million to their family or their heirs, totally tax-free, not taxed at death, not taxed by the heirs. It's a very bad bill, a step in the wrong direction. Thank you.
I would have absolutely voted no on this tax bill, and here's why. I think the benefit really was mainly for the big corporations. And while there are benefits in that, I think that we should have had a more equitable reallocation so that maybe more of the working families would have permanent tax cut and more incentives or tax credit for the small businesses. So I think we have to really look at the equitable benefit of that tax bill. Secondly, I think when you have a state and local tax deduction limit, that really puts a burden on state and local municipalities in terms of raising funds for the resources and the issues that are really important for our local community, like education, like emergency responses, housing. These are all issues that need to be really funded by local and state, and that's not going to be able to be done if we have this state and local tax limit. Lastly, I think when you're looking at the mortgage interest deduction, I think that really affects California more than any other places. So I think for all of these issues that really matter to Californians and the local people and the small business in the community, I think this tax bill was not a good one economically, and I would have not voted for it.
I think overall, this was good for the nation. When you cut taxes, it stimulates the economy, and while we've had a very long peacetime expansion of our economy, there was indicators it was about to turn down, you see the economy continuing to expand. Was it perfect? No, but you saw many of these, and some of my colleagues over here said that it is just for the big corporations. Well, the big corporations do happen to employ people to get salaries, and you saw many of them give bonuses, they gave raises, right away. Getting that money repatriated from other countries back here to invest is a very positive thing. And so there are a lot of good things to like about this tax package. And frankly, we're not going to know for a while what all was in there because that's the way it takes. As you do your taxes, you're going to find out whether you have plus or minus your own column. Having said that, had I been not back there, I wouldn't have supported it. And I wouldn't have supported it because it hurt California overall. Good for the nation, it was bad for us. And as a representative of the 39th District, I'm looking out for us. And why was it bad for us? Because of some of their articulation already happened. The inability to deduct taxes past a certain threshold in mortgage interest is a huge problem in California because we're a high-cost state, high-tax state. And so with our California delegation, we should have had enough clout to insist, maybe raise the corporate tax a little bit more, but we should have protected our citizens first. I wouldn't have supported it.
Our next question is have to do with trade. That's in the news a lot now with the administration imposing tariffs, threatening to pull out of NAFTA, already pulled out of the Trans-Pacific, or did not join in the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and basically is taking more of a confrontational stance, if you will, as far as trade is concerned. So we start now with you, Ms. Kim. How do you feel about the issue of trade, tariffs, NAFTA, etc.?
Thank you for the question, Rick. For over two decades, I've worked on this issue. I'm a proponent of trade. Our district relies heavily on trade with our allies. The recent tariff on steel is creating a trade war, which I'm concerned about. The rhetorics, the tone that's coming out, it's really, the allies are already retaliating. They are putting tariffs on something else. You know, it's not the way to do it, but we need trade. California is known as the Pacific Rim, the gateway to Pacific Rim. We rely heavily on this. If we shut ourselves out and go this route of fighting with our allies, we need to be working together to improve our economy. This is not the way to do it. I am concerned about the trade war that is going on. Countries are retaliating, and I think this is this is not the way that I'll be supported. But again, I'm a very pro-trade person, and my record in the state assembly shows that we need to be able to trade with our trading partners in order to make our America more strong, economically. Thank you so much.
So free trade requires fairness, and I would hope that we're all for free trade, but we've had one problem over decades, and that is that the United States has been overwhelmingly willing, in many cases, particularly in China, to be a punching bag and look the other way out of politeness because we don't want to start a trade war, so we let people take off with our technology, which was second to none, and we are being threatened in that regard any longer. We're looking at our trade secrets, copyright, that they run all over. It is very unfortunate that in order to get to fairness, you have to threaten to do anything. But anyone that's been in business, which is what the Chamber of Commerce is all about, knows one thing. If you negotiate from a position of weakness, you're going to lose every time. If you negotiate from a position of strength, you've got a shot. And if you don't have anything that's, you know, at risk, the odds of getting a decent result are limited. This president has an unusual way of doing things, but he's also an exceptional negotiator, and it's largely why he brought it in. If you look at his deals, he's a billionaire for one reason.
Come on, folks.
Hey, love him or hate him. The guy burned his way into the White House when everyone underestimated him. He got there on his own. And
I'll give you 15 more seconds, Sean.
You're going to see in virtually every one of these cases, you already see people backing off on trade tariffs so long as people are coming to the table. And you're going to see China and the United States work this out, but without threatening anything and having taken the brunt of unfair trade, we'd never get anywhere.
Good. Time's up.
Well, it's certainly true that international trade is a complex structure, and you can always find areas where you can improve. But it is also the perfect example of why this administration is a total failure. You don't deal with allies the way this administration deals with them. The entire basis of the prosperity of the United States and of the entire prosperity of the world since World War II is based on multilateral trade. This administration wants to replace multilateral trade with bilateral trade agreements. It doesn't work. Under President Bush, he put on tariffs almost identical to what President Trump has put on, and he saved about 2,000 jobs in the steel and aluminum business. And according to all the conservative economists, we lost 200,000 jobs in other industries who had to pay more for steel and aluminum. The way towards prosperity is to continue down the path of reducing trade barriers, having better relations, not worse relations. I've been an international businessman since 1999. I've negotiated insurance contracts in Indonesia, in Serbia, in Kazakhstan, in the former Soviet Republic of Georgia, in China. I have two partners in China, major insurance companies. I never threatened them. Never threatened them, they never threatened me. We sat down and we found areas of mutual interest. We signed contracts. We make money together. We do business together. They provide their expertise and I provide mine. And that's a model that this country used to follow, and I'd like to see us continue to follow it in the future. Thank you.
Free trade agreements have been at the basic foundation of the global economy and the growth of our economy throughout the world, particularly the U.S. economy. So I think that fair trade agreements like NAFTA has actually been very beneficial. And studies have shown that. So why would you want to start a global trade war? So this tariff that President Trump decided to have on steel and aluminum is an absolute economic disaster. You look at 2002, when the same tariff was put in, we lost 200,000 jobs, like Andy said. And estimates have projected that for every one steel job that you save, there are five other jobs in industries that use steel that we would lose jobs on. So job loss, consumer prices are going to go up in the U.S. And lastly, this trade war that we've seen has caused the market to collapse a few hundred points. Right? Trade war is never good for a global economy, one that's based on making sure that we have fair trade and making sure that we have standards that are profitable and also protective of workers and the environment. So overall, fair trades are very important. Trade war is not.
I think NAFTA has functioned as we hoped it would. You know, Mexico and Canada are number one, number two markets in the world. We work closely together. In fact, with Mexico's economy building because of NAFTA, we have so many businesses that are down there, that there's more jobs. We've had a net migration out of California and back into Mexico because there's a lot of jobs there. It's once again a growing economic opportunity. Shouldn't have to be revisited periodically and make sure it's working right? Sure, I think that's a good idea with any business agreement. You don't just set something off and go in a direction and hope it continues. You gotta revisit and make sure that it's doing what you expected it to. As for the aluminum and the steel tariffs, I think that's short-sighted. I can understand the reason. You have a rust belt and it's a campaign promise. I admire that the president followed up his campaign promise. I just wouldn't have made that promise in the first place, because there's so many other businesses that are suffering because of that, and we will all be paying a higher price. It's not a strategic material, so I don't see the need for that. As far as the stated purpose for tariffs for China, I agree with it. The stated purpose was that the intellectual property is being pirated, and they need to respect that. That's a long-term problem. I don't think that a trade war is the way to go about that. I wish he'd done it in a different manner, but his objective is certainly noble. But perhaps the discussion of diplomacy first and then the trade war later would have been a better approach.
So I worked in the Obama administration when TPP was first being considered. I was the chief of staff right before the votes were going on. I'll be frank with everyone in this room. That deal did not consider anyone here. It was behind closed doors. It wasn't raising standards on workers or the environment or intellectual property. If you're a member of Congress, you couldn't even take a pen and paper in the room to take notes. My concern with our trade agreements is they're all done in secret and they're all done just for the big guys. More so what's happening in our politics, it's all partisan. Three people on this panel would be voting yes for whatever Trump comes up there. There is no way in truth that they're going to stand up to Trump on this tariff, because the Republican caucus had to stand up to Trump on this tariff. The reality is we need people to go to Washington and fight for us. If you're a small business owner, you need someone to make sure that you're in that room on that negotiation. It's not behind closed doors. And when you're looking at these agreements, we need to focus on making sure our companies can export their products overseas. Build it here and sell it everywhere. That's what we were focused on in the Commerce Department. But that's not what our government's doing right now. And so if elected to Congress, I will promise you one thing. I will fight for you on these trade agreements. I don't care if it's a Democratic president or a Republican president, especially if it's this president. If it's not a good deal for the 39th District, it's not a good deal for me, and I will fight back. And right now, those tariffs are a bad deal. TPP's out there, still a bad deal. And we need to make sure that we're looking at a deal that's going to help us compete globally. Help us be able to build here again. Thank you.
So let's move on to regulations. And we'll start with you, Mr. Nelson. On regulations, as you know, the Trump administration is undoing many of the executive orders of the Obama administration, and essentially philosophically is narrowing, if you will, the reach and purview of the federal government, suggesting that many issues are better handled by the states. In general, let's make this a 60-second question. How do you feel philosophically about the issue of regulations, more or less?
Other than the appointment of a Supreme Court justice, the most significant thing this administration has done is cut regulations and free up business to do what business is supposed to do. Now, that doesn't mean you pollute the environment, you roll over all the workers. The bottom line is, red tape is what makes it hard to do business in California, but easier in Texas, and it's what makes it difficult to do business in the United States, where a lot of our competitors have a cleaner shot from conception to production. And the United States needs to embrace low barriers to entry and for no cost, get out of the way of private business. We have the most incredible entrepreneurs on the globe in the United States. We are the hotbed of invention and innovation. We have been since the beginning of the last century, and we certainly shouldn't stop now. Getting out of people's way is the right way to grow business.
Well, philosophically, I don't believe in more or less regulation. I believe in efficient regulation. I think you have to start, and I'm looking forward to need a strong regulatory environment to do that. Now, many regulations can be inefficient, they can be bureaucratic, they need to be repealed. The Trump administration has repealed common sense and rules that allow coal companies to discharge waste into the streams right in communities. So there are many regulations that we need that the Trump administration has tried to do away with. So the goal, philosophically, is to have efficient regulation to protect consumers in those areas where we cannot produce the goods ourselves. That's the purpose of regulation. I think the United States generally strikes a pretty good balance.
As a small business owner, my main issue and my main concern every day is to be able to effectively provide my service or good, be able to make the profit, and be able to take care of my employees with all the benefits that I think that they need to have in terms of good living wages and benefits. So any ability to let me do my job as a small business owner is great. Now, regulations that help me to do that would be absolutely wanted and it would be effective, but unnecessary regulations that would impede my ability to do my job as a small business owner, I think would be absolutely not. So again, I think what Andy's saying is absolutely correct. We need effective and efficient regulations, but not to the point where we would actually impede small business owners' ability to conduct their business and take care of their employees.
I applaud President Trump for undoing some of the regulations that were put in place by executive order. Regulations stifle creativity. Regulations stifle job creation. We had somebody talking about the first 3 to 5 years being so important to young businesses. And I got to tell you, the regulations get in the way of that innovation as well. When you think of when we made the transition from horse and buggy to car, what was it the government did? Not much. When you look at the Wild West up in Silicon Valley, that's actually the economic engine that drives California, what we're known for worldwide, carries us through recessions. It's innovation, and it tends to be not heavily regulated. It's only when they start to get mature they get regulated. But having regulations is cumbersome. Letting them go and fly into the wind and be creative is what makes California great. I don't have confidence that if we let federal regulations come to the state, it's going to be better. We got 27,000 pages of regulation state code.
So I believe in smart regulations. And that comes down to things like the Clean Air, Clean Water Act. We all remember smog alerts. We've seen what's happened in Michigan with Flint. We know in Fullerton the water situation here as well. But beyond that, when it comes to regulations, it's about leadership. Because a lot of times we don't actually update our rules. When I was at the Commerce Department, we were updating Cold War era regulations on what you can and can't sell overseas. We had products that you can buy at Radio Shack that were over-regulated that you couldn't sell them. But neither party was willing to update those because they didn't want to stand in the way of incumbent business interests. When I was working in the solar industry, we had the big guys, the fossil fuel guys, the utility companies, basically using the regulatory process to stifle our growth. So I believe when it comes to regulation, you gotta be smart, and you gotta be willing to say no. Three of these folks up here have never said no to a lobbyist dollar, whether it's on healthcare, whether it's on gun control, or whether it's on gifts from contractors. They don't say no. So when they're saying no regulation, they're not saying no regulation. They're saying regulation for the guys they don't like, but the ones they do, they'll just sit by and let them make a profit.
Look, I live in the state of California, where it's known to be one of the most regulated, overtaxed states. And when I served in the state assembly, I served as the vice chair of the Jobs, Economic Development, and the Economy. One of the first things I did was to work with my bipartisan Democrat chairman of the committee to put together a committee hearing to bring together the businesses here to tell us, instead of us telling them, what are the impediments or what are the good things and bad things that help you want to stay in the California, or what are the things that make you drive out of this state of California. And you know what? One of the things that said was, we're already overregulated. Overregulation is what keeps businesses out of state. And the people said they love California sunshine, but they hate the regulation. We need to do everything we can to make sure that we have a business-friendly environment. And I'm very, very proud that when I was served over there, I worked really hard to cut regulation at every state, every position, and working closely with the local chambers of commerce, I was able to work on a streamlined business process. Thank you so much.
Let's see, I think Mr. Jamal did make a reference to one or more people on stage being lobbyists, but you didn't say any names. So unless if any of you took offense to that, there were no names mentioned. If anybody took offense, you could have 30 seconds. But I guess since you mentioned no names.
Never mentioned names. They could raise their hand if they knew they were a tool lobbyist.
Yes.
Anyone? Raise their hand if they felt they were totally obvious.
I have been asked by the chamber to tell the audience that they're putting a lot of weight on business-oriented questions. Apparently, some people are submitting questions that aren't too business-oriented. So don't be overly upset if your question's not being asked. But if you could phrase it in kind of a business way, that will work better. And I noticed there's been a lot of boisterous applause, and that's fine. But if you extend it, it's like some of you want to just keep extending it longer and longer. That will cut into the time of the candidates up here. So just try to, if you want to applaud, that's great, but don't stretch it out for half a minute. Okay, our next question, I believe, Mr. Thorburn, you start on this one. Infrastructure. Infrastructure is kind of like the weather. Everybody talks about it, but nobody's doing much about it. And even today, I think the president made some reference to his ideas for investing in the infrastructure. So, each of you, I want to ask you, what would you do about the infrastructure? And give me an idea of like what kind of dollars are you talking about? What's the magnitude? And how would you pay for it?
Thank you. First of all, I would say that we definitely need to have a major infrastructure spending program in the country. We're way behind. Most of you have probably seen the numbers about how much money it would take to get our roads and bridges and water supplies and sewer supplies, projects up to date. So the question is, how do you pay for it? And I think there's relatively easy ways to pay for it. I want to mention two of them. First of all, somebody else mentioned that one of the only good things in this tax reform bill was that companies are repatriating money and paying taxes on profits they have overseas. That's hundreds of billions of dollars in taxes that will come back to the United States. I believe that all of that money, the taxes paid on overseas earnings, should be sequestered in a separate account and be used only for infrastructure programs on a matching basis with the states and municipalities. So you work out a formula that says any state that puts up money will take these taxes that are paid on repatriated profits and overseas earnings and will put that into an infrastructure fund. A second example is Medicare for All. I'm a big supporter, in fact, that we need to have move as quick, not the one that President Trump is supposedly keeps promising that has to do with private enterprise is going to pay for it. It's not going to work. It has to be done by the government, with government funds taken from repatriation of overseas profits and from redoing our medical care system, and we'll have plenty of money to do it. Thank you.
I absolutely believe that we need to repair our infrastructure, and it's mainly because it's a safety issue, but it's also a great way to create jobs. So to pay for the infrastructure repair, I think that President Trump's proposal is absolutely unrealistic. It's not feasible to have such a large bill being basically, contributed by local and state as well as private. I just think it's not a feasible setup that he's proposed. The way that we would get to that would be to really cut out on some of the waste in some of the departments of the government. Let's look at the Department of Defense. The DoD has said over and over that if we were to look at closing some of the bases that they've recommended, we actually can save a lot of money and use that money toward rebuilding our infrastructure. So shifting our priorities, trying to cut waste in areas like the Department of Defense, where we can actually save quite a bit of money if we do a lot of auditing, I think that that would be one of the ways to really fund the infrastructure plan that that President Trump has.
Thank
If I were to look at each of your checkbooks, I would find out what your priorities are. And I don't know if that's movies, it's eating out, whatever it is in your life, you would find it by looking at how you spend your money. It's no different when you look at government. We fund our priorities, and infrastructure hasn't been a priority. Because they know at some point in time, they're going to be able to make the pitch and go out to you again, the taxpayer, and say, hey, our roads are crumbling, our dams are crumbling, we need more money. And you will give to something that's tangible that you can see a need for. That's what they did in the state of California. That's why they raised the gas tax and did the license fee, because it wasn't a priority. And by the way, in that case, they were already taking $1 billion a year, actually $1.1 billion a year, of transportation money and putting it to other parts of the budget. So the first and foremost thing is transportation taxes should be going to our transportation infrastructure. That's pretty simple, but it doesn't happen now. Back in Congress, I would bring back our fair share of the transportation taxes we're already paying. You know, we're a donor state. We pay more transportation taxes to Washington, D.C. than what comes back here, and that should stop. We're the number one state. We have a lot of needs. We certainly have transportation needs, but bring back what already being paid is a good first start, and then reprioritize so that it has a continually ongoing part of the budget so we can fund our important infrastructure.
So I grew up here, and I was gone for 11 years, and I remember when you used to be able to drive down Orangeburg, and it didn't feel like you were off-roading, because there weren't those potholes. Three of these folks on here have been in office and oversaw the complete deterioration of our infrastructure. Are they going to go to Washington and fight for our infrastructure if they have a proven track record of doing nothing? I don't think so. So the problem we have with infrastructure is a couple things. One, we need to actually fix the basic fundamentals of our roads. We need to address the fact that 57 to 60 is the third worst interchange in America. That's embarrassing. We need to address that. More so, we also need to build for the future of our infrastructure. That's making sure we electric vehicle car charging stations. It's making sure we modernize our grid. That's making sure we build a cybersecurity infrastructure, because that's a reality of today's economy. And so when I look at it, it is roads and bridges and making sure our highways are good. And that's the bare minimum we have to do. And we do have to sequester those funds. And we do have to actually spend the money. So how I would approach is a couple things. One, I would go to the cities and talk to them first and foremost and say, what do you need? What are some of the funds that we need so we can build an infrastructure bill that makes sense for that city's plan? How would I pay for it? I'd make sure we're funding government more efficiently by not spending on things we don't need, like some of these F-18 fighter jets, but also finding different savings in each department. I worked at Congress when we were going through the sequester, so I saw that we found efficiencies. We can find more spending efficiencies and do this. We just actually have leadership who actually wants to do it.
For the time I served in the California State Assembly, I served on the California Transportation Committee. I've seen people come before our committee talking about high-speed rail. We all know it's a high-speed rail that's going nowhere. And every time, every year, every 2 years, whatnot, people, you are asked to tax yourselves to get more transportation funding or to take care of our roads and infrastructure needs. But let me remind you, first of all, why we got to where we are today. We have a bad spending habit out there. The politicians in Sacramento and Washington, D.C., they are very good at dipping their hands into the pocket of money that has been allocated for our transportation needs, using it for something else to fund their pet projects like California Highway, the high-speed rail, and then they come back and say, we don't have money. People, you need to tax yourselves to get that additional money. That's not the way to do it. How do we pay for it? Let's stop before it bleeds anymore. Redirect the money that is allocated for high-speed rail, because that is tied to federal funding. The federal government already said, we don't have money. It's not going to get built. So redirect it. I led the effort in the assembly, work with my colleagues to make sure that money is redirected to take care of the roads, repairs, maintenance, and the infrastructure that we need. And how do we do it again? Bring back the P3s concept. Private-public partnership. Thank you.
So my last 8 years have been spent as your county supervisor, but what you may or may not know is much of what county supervisors do is serve as board members of other organizations. I've been the chairman of the Orange County Transit Authority and a key member for the last 8 years. We have the best freeway system in California, and it wasn't because it was perfect 8 years ago. North County in particular, where I serve, you name me one freeway you can get on today that hasn't been widened again in the last 8 years, with our money, because we responsibly spent it. The 405 freeway, which is not in our district, but it's certainly a place a lot of us go to work, is about to undertake the most expensive expansion and construction project in Orange County's history for two reasons. One, we taxed ourselves to produce results for our citizens, and two, since we had the money, the federal government saw us to be so attractive that we got a TIFIA loan, a very low-cost loan, that we'll pay back. It made a $2 billion project possible. That's how you build infrastructure. We have a lot of organizations in Orange County Water District, or Bruce Whitaker serves for Fullerton, that have AAA rated. They are good credit risks, and they can pay back major infrastructure projects. We have to fund them with low-cost government loans, backed up by skin in the game, and if we do that time and time again, we have won right here in your district, and the results are for all to see. No one can compete with our freeway system, because we built it.
Ms. Kim brought up the bullet train, so this sets up our first lightning round, okay? And so this one won't even take 15 seconds each. And we'll start again. It's still, you're still on the clock, Mr. Thorburn, so we'll start with you again. Just simple yes or no. Are you for the bullet train project or against it?
I'm basically for it.
I'm for it as well.
Against?
I'm for us leading innovation, so I'm for the bullet train.
I'm against it.
I'm against the fantasy that will never be finished.
Okay, thank you. Let's move on. And by the way, thank you that the audience, your applause was terrific. That all right, now that we're warmed up, let's really get into it. Our next topic is integration. And you'll get 90 seconds each. Take this wherever you want, but philosophically, how you feel about integration, what it means for the workforce, what it means as far as social services, what would you do about the issue of undocumented residents, the Dreamers, the border wall, and sanctuary cities. And Dr. Tran, I think you get to start this one.
As a refugee who came over from Vietnam, I absolutely believe that immigrants make up the fabric of this country. And we've contributed so much, not just to the culture and the flavors, but also the economic growth of this country. And I absolutely believe that a lot of the undocumented people in our community contributed significantly for the growth of this state, certainly, but also the national economy. So looking at the investment that we put into our DACA recipients and the Dreamers, an economic investment, I think that we need to absolutely give them the papers, the pathway to citizenship. I think that we've made the economic investment in these people. We need to continue to give them the security protection we need. We need to have comprehensive immigration reform. But I think this border issue is something that is so un-American. We absolutely need to secure our border. We can do it through technological ways rather than actually building a wall.
I get upset when people try to frame the discussion of immigration and in a way that blurs the distinction between legal immigrants and undocumented immigration. There's a huge difference. My wife is here tonight. Mamie became an immigrant from Taiwan. She became a citizen along with her family members. We're a nation built of immigrants, and it is their innovations, their energy, their drive that has helped make us the greatest nation in the world. But we have to protect our borders. We have to secure our borders. For those that think that's a fantasy or think that somehow that's a mean and evil spirit, what do you think is happening when you drive from Tijuana up to California? You're going through a border control area. When you land in an airplane at LAX and you go through immigration, you're going through immigration. We have border control, we just have porous borders. If you can walk walk across in a place that's not your normal place. So let's knock off this fantasy that we don't have border security in some places and it's somehow okay to let them just come across elsewhere. We've got to secure the borders. Not everybody is here looking for the American dream. 911 changed things. We found out some people want to cross have other things in mind. And when you look at that, you have guns coming across, you have money going the other direction, you have drugs, you have human trafficking, you have all kinds of problems that we can solve by securing the border. I do think we have to take care of the DACA problem. We can't send them back. The reality is they're more American than they are from another country. And we just got to have a comprehensive immigration reform that takes care of all these needs.
So I first want to address the comment on the border, because I've been to the border. I went to the southwest border in Arizona. Our border has billions of dollars spent each year. We already functionally have a lot of that wealth, different technology. So this is just a talking point to scare people to say the borders are porous. Undocumented immigration from Mexico has been down each and every year. We're already spending billions. We don't need to double down. We actually fix our system through comprehensive immigration reform. But more so, we also need not demonize immigrants, because we all have to live in this community. Immigrants are a part of our community. I thought it was despicable what the county board of supervisors did this week by demonizing immigrants just so they got a talking point for this campaign. And Sean, I sent you a note saying let's have a town hall on immigration, answer community questions, and talk about our plans. We don't have too long for that, but let's actually have them answer questions instead of demonizing immigrants. Let's not just go on Fox News and attack folks who are cleaning our tables, who are cleaning our houses, and are helping build our economy. Let's actually talk about solutions. Let's make sure we have our visa system work. It will help our 75% of our agricultural workers. If you're eating a salad, that salad was picked by immigrants. We can't just abandon immigrants because it's a talking point in a campaign, and we can't just go out there and say we're going to do nothing and blame the immigrants and have an imaginary border crisis. We need to make sure our system works so people can come here legally. We need to address the dreamer situation so they can have a path to citizenship. We need to make sure their parents have a path to citizenship. This is a part of our economy as Californians. Let's be real and let's lead. Let's not have Donald Trump dance around and just copy him for a primary.
Ms. Kim, you're next in line, so you'll go next. But Sean, I think I'll tack on 15 seconds to your time on that.
I waited for the applause to Andrea too. I truly believe that we need to have a DACA fix and have a conversation like an adult in the room. We cannot expect DACA beneficiaries to continue to live in fear, hoping and praying that nobody will come and apprehend me and then put me on a bus or airplane somewhere and then ship them back to wherever they came from. Wherever they came from, all their lives they've known the United States to be their own country. Now,
they don't have one because Obama rightfully offered 750,000 people a path to get out of trouble. Donald Trump offered 1.8 million. That was a reasonable compromise, more than reasonable. But the fact is, even at that level, nobody took them up on the offer. We have, that's a fact.
No, it's not.
There is no reason that anyone should expect the United States to tolerate a porous border. It's a right of every nation. No nation would put up with people just picking and choosing when they would like to cross the border. And the idea that this problem's been nipped in the bud. We had amnesty in the mid-80s, and the idea was we wouldn't be reliving this again. But we didn't secure the border. How did that work out? We've got a major problem. Whatever your view is, we have a crisis because we didn't handle it the last time. We can have strict border control and significant legal immigration. We can have both, and we should. We need to take care of American citizens and protect safety. The Board of Supervisors in the County of Orange took a position on one issue, laws that deal with incarcerated people being released without even the ability to communicate with federal authorities because, at least as of a few days ago, the Attorney General threatened our sheriff with arrest. That's unacceptable, and I won't put up with it.
Clearly, our immigration.
immigration system is broken, but I think you can see the reason it's not fixed right here in the panel. We do have a very good example here, because it sounds like at least four or five of the people on this panel, Republicans and Democrats, believe in immigration, comprehensive immigration reform. Why doesn't it happen? Because it's time that we took back the House and made it into a Democratic House to stand up against what's going on in Washington right now. Washington right now is controlled from top to bottom by the same ideology. Even though it appears that a lot of people are in favor of comprehensive immigration reform, a path to citizenship for the DACA, there's a 10-year wait to get a visa overseas. The system is totally broken. We have to fix the system. And the way we're going to fix the system is to change the tone of the debate. You're not going to fix the system by demonizing immigrants. You're not going to fix the system by attacking them. You can't ban Muslims, a billion people, and then say we're friendly to immigrants. The way to fix the system is the way you fix all the other problems that you have in the country, is you have to sit down in a thoughtful manner with plans that are well thought out. You can't be confrontational on every single issue every day of the week. Well, you heard the word crisis. The crisis is manufactured. There's no crisis of immigrants. They're more peaceful than the regular rest of our society. They commit fewer crimes. They contribute to society. It's a totally manufactured crisis by President Trump and his supporters, as Sam said, for political reasons. There is no immigration. There's things we have to do. We need a secure border. We only have 40,000 Border Patrol people right now. Maybe we need 40,000 in two. I don't know what the number is. But it's not a porous border, and there is no crisis. We just have to make some minor adjustments and then go to a comprehensive reform.
I can tell some of you still want to stay on this topic, and it's obviously one of the audience is interested in. So just a quick show of hands. How many of you are in favor of a DACA fix? Is that everybody? Yes, okay, all right. How many of you favor the anti-sanctuary city stance that the Board of Supervisors has taken? Okay, let's go. Our next, let's move on. Sorry, folks, we're going to move on. And the next topic, another very important topic, healthcare. And I think we start with you, Mr. Huff. What in general is your view about healthcare reform? Do you think we should repeal, or as you know, there's been some attempts to repeal unsuccessfully the Affordable Care Act, even though there's been action through the budget and executive order that has chipped away at it. But do you think the Affordable Care Act should be fixed, should be repealed, and how do you feel about universal / single-payer health care?
Well, I do think that Obamacare was flawed. Under that, people saw a rise in cost. They saw a rise in deductibles, so that even though people were insured, many people couldn't afford to pay the deductible. So it did help many hospitals, at least when people walked through the door, they had more of them recovered. And frankly, California did a better job of implementing Obamacare than the rest of the nation. That's true, because we went out and aggressively helped bring people in. When you had the mandate, it put some more money into the system. The problem is, it's still broken. And it has become exacerbated by some of the actions that have happened. So what would I do? I think you got to have portability of insurance. Once you get insurance, you should be able to go from one job to another and not have to all this trading. You should have more transparency in insurance, in costs, for goodness sakes. There's nothing more complicated than going to get an x-ray and you got three different bills on the same thing from three different people. You need to do a better job of that. You'd have information that goes from one platform to another. Some of that stuff was tried to be addressed by Obamacare, but it just wasn't implemented. The individual mandate was really tough on young kids who didn't need it, couldn't afford it, but it is a real problem. So we should have more of the health plans where you can put money in ahead of time and draw it out as you need it, and also the reimbursement accounts where businesses can help augment the high deductibles and help cover their folks that way. There's a lot of things we can do to make it work, but it has been broken, and Obamacare is broken.
So how many folks here are on Medicare or know someone on Medicare? Raise your hand. This has to be everybody. You must know someone on Medicare. If you hate that Medicare, or that you first you know that has it, wishes it would go away, you didn't have it, keep your hand up. Just one person right here wants to get rid of Medicare. The reality is Medicare works. It's one of our most proven and effective programs in our government. So number one, when it comes to healthcare, we need to preserve what works. The Trump tax bill is going to add a $1.5 trillion deficit hole. Paul Ryan's already announced he's going to go after Medicare and Social Security to fix that hole. I will stand up to make sure we protect Medicare. Second, Medicare works. We should be investing in what works and scaling it. I worked in business. I was in the startup space. You invest in what works and scales it. So we need to expand Medicare. I believe in Medicare for all. We may not get the right way, but we need to start lowering that age. In particular, with automation, it's going to change the fundamental nature of our economy. A lot of folks are going to be out of jobs. So we're going to need to make sure they have health care during that transition. And that's why we need to lower that Medicare age. In addition to the ACA, we're going to have to fix it. There are some improvements we need to make. First and foremost, we need to lower the cost of prescription drugs and allow more generics. In addition, we need to make sure those marketing prices for drug companies, all we see on commercials all the time, that we make sure there's a cap on that, because it shouldn't be the case you're spending higher dollars on drugs just so some actors can have a bad TV ad. We need to make sure we control these costs. And Medicare, when you expand it, you have a better negotiating power to make sure you lower those costs.
The intent of Obamacare was to ensure that there is access for all Americans to be insured. But what it did at the end of the day is that it has given us nothing but broken promises. While it may have given a lot of Americans access to health care, it has given less than acceptable quality health care. The premiums have gone up. And there is a penalty clause if you don't have the health care. This is, it's an inability to keep the original intended promise. The Medicare for All we're talking about, I don't think this fringe policy has any consensus in Sacramento or in Washington, D.C. Overall, the program is not working, and it's bankrupting the system where I saw a lot of hands go up here. We depend so much on Medicare and Medicare, but they are broken because, you know what, in order to ensure everybody, everybody's paying for something about it, but you are the one, your group is the one that is being hurt the most. We need to fix this, but I will not ask for a complete repeal unless there is a solution that can be sensible and ensure all Americans by providing the quality care with the not too much high, premium should not be too much for this. So I'll be willing to sit down with you and maybe, discuss a sensible solution. Until I see a good replacement, complete repeal is not the way to do it.
Thank you. Obviously, we've got problems in healthcare, but understand, Obamacare is based on a simple principle that you've got to get everybody to pay in order to make it run. So the people that use the least healthcare, the young, have to be paying in order to float people who use the most at the top. This is the way the system works. But the flaw was, most of our children, I have two young adults, one getting there. Our children are overwhelmed. And that's not going to change anytime soon. Student debt's overwhelming, the job market's overwhelming, housing's expensive, etc. The idea that they are going to float the enormous baby boom generation, that the economic model is upset. The problem with going to nationalized health care, and you hear the fear, but it's real. The way you manage that, and don't blow your budget up, is you've got to start cutting back. Well, guess what? You can't cut services to people that don't use them. You can't cut health care to young people if they don't go to the doctor. And young people under 30 go to the doctor for what reason? Catastrophic illness, pregnancy, and maybe, checkups. If you're unfortunate enough to have cancer or something, obviously you're the exception to the rule, you need health care. But you can't have a model that requires this enormous subsidy and think you're going to just spread it to everybody. It'll bankrupt us all.
Well, it's going to be news to Western Europe that they're all bankrupt because they provide medical care to everybody.
Yeah.
I've been in the medical insurance business as CEO, major stockholder of an insurance company that sells medical insurance all over the world. I have clients in 150 countries. Many of those clients come back to the United States for treatment. We had to navigate our way through what is the most inefficient, overly expensive system in the world. And so here's what happens in the United States. We spend 18% of everything we earn on medical care, 18% of our entire gross domestic product. In Europe, they spend about 10 or 12%, sometimes even less. But what do we get for that? We get pretty good care, but our life expectancy is the lowest in the developed world. Our infant mortality rate is the highest in the developed world. Our cancer survivor rates are about average or worse than average. So what we end up with this system is paying the highest price in the world and getting less than average results. When the Affordable Care Act was first passed, here's the fact. For the first few years before the Republicans ripped it apart, premiums for health insurance for all ages went up at the lowest rate in 20 years because the Affordable Care Act was working, despite the fact that the Republicans fought against it even after it was passed. What we need to do is fix the Affordable Care Act and move towards a single-payer system as quickly as possible. Thank you.
Tried to give health insurance to my employees, every year our premium cost was going up, skyrocketing. So if you want to do the right thing, it's impossible. So the Affordable Care Act was the beginning of a framework that tried to cut down the rising cost of healthcare. And we did that by making sure that we have the concept of shared risk and shared benefit. Yes, there are going to be healthy people who will pay into it, but it helps so that the quality of care is maintained for the most of us. And the Affordable Care Act did give 20 million people coverage, which actually helped to reduce the cost of medicine, because these are the people who would have used the ER, they would have used other resources to really contribute to the cost of rising healthcare. And you know, giving a young person the ability to go into bankruptcy because he doesn't think he's going to need health care, that's not an option that I want to give my youth, my children. So we have to go back and look at how to improve on the Affordable Care Act. And the way to do that would be three objectives. One is to make sure access is still there for everyone. We need to make sure it's affordable. And affordability includes working with pharmacies and hospitals to really cut down on the charter. And lastly, we need to continue to work on quality. And that means that we give the providers an option to really do their best. And that's how we're going to try to contain the cost of healthcare in this country.
How many of you would favor, in the long run, a single payer system? You've all referenced programs, healthcare, infrastructure. So let's talk about the cost, federal budget, and the deficit. As you may know, in historical terms right now, if you want to disagree, do so in your statement, the deficit is about at historical levels. It's a percent of GNP, but the deficit is about at historical levels. The debt load of the United States is at an unprecedented level, you know, in modern times, with the exception of right after World War II, and it went down quickly after World War II, but it's now gone up quite a bit again. So the question is that a problem? And if so, how would you reduce it? And would you do anything about entitlements? And don't say waste and fraud unless you're going to say, because if you look at the amount of money that funds the government and even funds the military, that's a quarter of the budget. Two-thirds of the budget is entitlement programs, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, Medicare, veteran benefits, that kind of thing. So that's two-thirds of the budget. So is the deficit a problem? And if so, what would you do to reduce it?
So the deficit is a big problem, and this past December, the Republican Party made it worse through Trump's tax reform. A $1.5 trillion hole was putting our deficit that Mabel was already probably even worse. What does that mean for us? It means we're going to have fewer dollars coming from the federal government for our roads. It's going to mean that the federal government, when it comes to health care, education, spending for our veterans, is going to have to make some tough choices. But even more so, when you look at issues like climate change, what we saw this fall with Houston, with South Florida, with Puerto Rico, climate change is adding new costs to our deficit. And so when you have a Congress that's blowing holes in the deficit, refuses to pass timely appropriations bills, refuses to pass a budget, we're going to have some tough choices ahead. And so this is a problem. And when I look at it, you know, number one, I would draw a red line. I will not allow any cuts on Medicare or Social Security. Our seniors earned that. They worked for that, and that's a promise that we made to them. We have to keep that promise. But more so, we have to look at different ways to make sure our government's more efficient. We're going to have to modernize different aspects. I was at a federal agency. I was there during the sequester. We saved just each week $1 million a week just by having people in our bureau put on both sides of the paper. Now it's a 100-person bureau. You start adding that across the government, you can find different efficiencies. More so, though, we need to repeal Trump's tax reform and put something that actually makes sense for California and makes sense for the future of our country and put smart investments in so we can build for the future.
I think we all agree deficit is a problem, but you know what? I think more than anything, we just have to realize why we're at this point. We just have a lot of bad habit of spending. We need to control our spending problem, both in Washington, D.C., and Sacramento, wherever it may be. One of the ways to do that is to make sure that we work on cutting regulations, allowing the business to succeed, give them the opportunity to do what they know best. We just cannot meddle into their businesses and just give a more, regulation on top of regulations. Yes, passing a balanced budget is important, but when you do, you have to look at the categorical items and figure out where we can cut spending to make sense. I agree with my, what Sam just said. When you look at the budget, look, for example, the benefits the veterans are receiving, when you ask them to serve and they come back, they deserve. When they serve, you need to take care of them when they come back, right? I mean, again, that's where we need to go. Okay, I would take care of this situation by cutting regulations and making our business and American economies grow.
So obviously this is not going to be an easy fix. I think the reality is, although it would be cute to say, hey, I support a balanced budget amendment, there's no way you're going to get there without cuts that no one's going to be willing to make. I think a realistic approach is if you would at least freeze spending, you'd eventually catch up. Our debt is going to be at a historic level, but you're also going to see our revenues at a historic level. It does catch up, and we are doing well. But one of the major problems this country has, why are we borrowing money to give it away to foreign nations? Now, some need it more than others, and you could argue that there's an exception for every place we give it. But I don't feel comfortable that our nation borrows hundreds of billions of dollars to give away to other nations. There's going to have to be a real conversation that other than a military-related crisis, a real one, not playing the world's police officer, we can't be giving borrowed money away. Maybe that'll force some discipline. I'd like to hope so. I'm a little skeptical. But at minimum, when you're borrowing money you don't have, it makes as much sense as someone that can't pay their mortgage, maxing out their credit card, to go give gifts to their friends. We can't afford to do that. It doesn't matter if we get results. If we don't take care of our own ship and we don't write the budget, it will overcome our children, that there's no way we're going to get out of this mess if we don't start freezing spending and holding on.
Well, I think it's certainly true that the budget deficit is headed in the wrong direction, and it will become a problem in the future. But fortunately, it happens that it is an easy fix. And let's talk about borrowed money. The tax bill that was just passed is an exact example of borrowed money. The United States government is going to issue $1.3 trillion worth of bonds in the next 10 years. They're going to take that money from investors, and two-thirds of it will go to multinational companies in the top 10%.
We're borrowing money to give it to corporations at a time when American corporations had record profits. They did not need a tax cut. All-time record profits reflected in a high stock market. And let's look at history. You want to fix the budget deficit. President Obama, in the first year, passed a stimulus program. The budget deficit went up. Every year after that, under President Obama, the deficit went down as a percentage of the budget, year by year. The Republicans, who historically said we have to balance the budget, came in and busted the budget. They're the ones who put it back on the wrong track. And people don't remember, when was the last time we had an actual budget surplus? Does anybody remember? President Clinton. And how did he do that? Did he lower taxes? No. He raised taxes on the wealthy people. And the Republicans said, oh, you're going to bust the budget. You won't get any revenue. When you raise taxes, people avoid them. And they don't work as hard. And President Clinton produced a budget deficit 2 years in a row. And the magazines were writing, there'll be no more 10-year bonds in the United States. It's an easy fix if we have the discipline that we had in the past and we overturn the Trump tax cut. Thank you.
I think it's all about priorities. The tax cut that was passed in December really gave corporations a benefit. We didn't have to go that far. I think enough to just continue to stimulate the economy, but we don't have to give them such a big tax cut. Secondly, I think it's about the priorities. So we're going to give such a huge tax cut and then put it on the shoulders of the elders, right? The children, the sick, right? We cannot do that. So we need to continue to fund Medicare, Medicaid, services for the veterans. So then it's about the shifting of priorities again. Why are we putting in our resources to fight some of these wars that we really did not give us any political or any economic benefit? We need to shift our spending away from, I think, some of the military spending. And I think we need to also look at the defense, the Department of Defense and the cuts that we can make there. Even their own auditing said that we can actually save so much money by closing some of the bases. Let's do it. Let's listen to their own recommendation and start shifting our priorities from a military base priority to one that really value our children and our seniors and our, the education and all the services that we need to provide.
The deficit and our national debt should be of concern to everybody, and certainly our kids, because they're the ones that have to wrestle with it. We will, certainly. Somebody here, most likely up here, will have to be wrestling with short term, long term. It's our kids. We have to get it under control. I will say, as far as how you pay for it, an expanding economy does generate more revenue. And it's very difficult to have a dynamic budget model that factors that. We tend to have a static budget model. But we'll get an opportunity to see if the tax cuts stimulate the economy such that we're generating the revenue that can help us bring the deficit down. I do believe in a balanced budget amendment. I know that if you don't have something to shoot for, you're sure to hit your target. And that's the target we should be hitting for, balancing the budget. I do believe if we don't get a budget on time, we shouldn't get paid. And I will fight for that back there. I think that's reasonable. When we did that up in Sacramento, if you remember how quickly we got a budget. Hold people's feet to the fire. But I believe that it is a challenging problem. It's one we have to solve. I think we can do it. I've served as a vice chair of budget up in Sacramento, and while I'm hearing a different definition of Democrats and Republicans up here, I tell you, Democrats are the problem in Sacramento. And they control both houses up there, and we keep spending more and more. And by the way, you keep getting taxed more and more because there's never enough money unless you draw a line and say, that's it, we're living within our means.
I'm going to have to turn this into a lightning round because we're low on time, and we really didn't get much into climate change and the environment. So I unfortunately can't give you all the 90 seconds, but let's just make it a quick lightning round. Show of hands, how many of you think California is doing enough to promote green energy? Doing enough? Or, all right. Well, you can raise your
twice the password. Now, how many of you think California is doing enough to promote green energy?
Is it not doing too much the same?
That's coming. That's coming. More, that's next. How many of you think California should be doing more to promote green energy? How many of you think California is being too heavy-handed in its environmental regulations? Okay. We've had a clean break on everything. Okay. And finally, how many of you think that the federal government should be putting, should give serious consideration, more serious consideration to nuclear energy as part of the energy fix, if you will, going forward? Okay. All right. Now, thank you so much. I didn't like your answers in the federal budget and deficit. I give you all a failing grade in math on that one. But that's my editorial comment. Excellent. I mean, really, I think you've all done a terrific job, and thank you very much. So now it's time for closing statements. And whose turn is it now? It's Ms. Kim. All right, Ms. Kim, you start. Closing statements.
Thank you very much, and thank you, audience, for listening to all of our different perspectives. And there are many issues that we've been discussing, but you can see why we differ. I think what you are seeing here is the passion and the commitment in all of us wanting to serve the public, and especially the people of the 39th Congressional District. I've had the opportunity to represent this district for over two decades when I worked with side by side with Congressman Ed Royce. And, you know, the most important thing is this. Whether we agree or disagree on many, many of the issues that we discussed today or even beyond, the important thing is you need a representative who will be there to represent you in Washington, D.C. The way to do it, we come together and have a discussion. We agree to disagree, but I will take your opinions in Washington, D.C., to be your representative of the 39th Congressional District. It's an opportunity for me to give back to the country that have given me so much. This is my adopted country I love. And I had the opportunity to serve, and I want to continue to serve you as your public servant and representative. Thank you so much.
Well, as you know, at least on the Republican side, none of us were planning on running for this office 90 days ago. It was a surprise. And it caused a lot of change in my life. But I knew one thing. The moment I heard that Ed Royce was retiring, there were two things that were required. Number one, you got to make a decision right now. I've seen the coronation happen before. But also, do you really have your heart in this district to do what's right for the people that live here? I have spent 8.5 years on the city council in this town, and I worked very well with everybody from every interest that we could work with to make things happen for Fullerton. The results are all around the downtown. When I got here, we spent money on all kinds of private interests, giving money to developers and redevelopment. We have worked tirelessly to make a difference for people. I've done the same at the county. I will do the same at the federal level. And despite disagreement with the people up here, one of my closest friends in politics is Luke Correa. He's a reasonable man. We need more people like that in politics. And agree or disagree, solutions can be found if you have people willing to look for them.
Well, thank you very much, everybody, for the questions, and thank you for your attentiveness. I'm running in this race because I think I really have the life experience that it takes to go to Washington and help turn the country around. I mentioned before, I've been a teacher, I've been an independent businessman, I've been an international businessman, I've worked for unions. So I know from the worker point of view, I know it from the employer point of view. And I want to take that attitude to Washington and try to get things done. What I want to do more than anything else is go to Washington and try to get us back on track of building an inclusive society. I want to stop demonizing people. I want to change the tone of government. I want to get back to government with high ethical standards. And I want to get back to a government that's committed to democracy. This administration is constantly attacking democratic ideals, constantly attacking ethics, constantly attacking people. I want to use my life experience to represent this district in the way that built this country, by representing working people, middle class people, and giving everybody a chance at opportunity. Thank you.
I begin tonight's discussion by telling you about two little girls who inspired me to run. So this race is really personal to me. Now I'm running for every child who doesn't have health insurance, every mother who worries about the care of her family, every dad who feels helpless to protect his children against gun violence, and for every woman whose face sexism and sexual violence. The issues that I'm running for are really important to the working families and the small businesses owners in this district. Right? With healthcare being out of reach by so many, it's imperative that we work to, you know, improve the Affordable Care Act so that no one's left out. And we need to make sure that we put emphasis on education so that our children can have the jobs of the future. Now, I've never, you know, ran away from the challenges of my life, and I am not going to do that at this very uncertain time. We need a Congresswoman who will fight for the America that we know and love, and for the vision of America that I know my Gracie wants to have.